Hey guys, Andre from High Performance Academy here. Welcome along to another one of our webinars. And today we're going to be looking at engine protection strategies, specifically on the Adaptronic modular ECU. This is something that basically most mainstream ECUs now provide. And it's something that surprisingly I see most tuners completely overlook and ignore. And this really can be something that could quickly and easily save your engine. Case in point, I suffered this failure myself the very last time I ran my old drag car docile Evo 3, for those who followed us, who used to have the world record for the fastest Mitsubishi Evo four-wheel drive with an 8.23 at 180 mile an hour. Very last time we raced that car, had an issue with the boost control strategy. Basically, long story short, I ended up requesting what I thought was going to be minimal boost for a shakedown pass just to get everything dialed in. The reality was, due to a software change in the ECU we were running, that actually almost requested maximum boost. So in the data log afterwards, looking at what was going on, we left the line with about 45 PSI. By the top of first gear, we were close to 60. By the time we were in second gear, we were over 65 PSI, which is the limit of the map sensor I was running. I have no clue how high the boost went. So first of all, in there, boost cut strategy would have helped. Subtle reasons why that didn't actually kick in at that point, but I won't get into that. The more important one was, and this is something we see a lot, particularly with paid drivers who don't really care so much about the mechanical package because they're not picking up the bill. We had exhaust gas temperature sensors in each exhaust runner on that particular engine to help with individual cylinder tuning. And as a precaution, I do set up driver warnings on the dash if the EGT goes above a certain level. And at the top of first gear, or I think it may have been as I pulled second gear, I had an EGT warning come up, and you literally got a tenth of a second here to think about what's going on. Everything felt really good. The car was hauling because it had 60 plus PSI of boost. I was also beating the guy in the other lane, so of course I stayed in it. About 2/10 of a second after that, it lifted the head and all of the water from the cylinder head sprayed up over the windscreen. Game over. So anyway, what I'm getting at here is engine protection strategies within the ECU take the decision away from the driver. There are pros and cons with doing that, but understanding those pros and cons allows you to weigh them up and make that decision. Anyway, we're going to get into our engine protection strategies as we get a little bit further through. Before we do that though, just cover off a few things that have been going on around here over the last couple of weeks since our last webinar. The first of these, and this is still running, so for those who joined us for our last webinar, you'll already heard this, but if you haven't got yourself into the draw, we are giving away a FuelTech FT550 ECU. So we'll head over to my laptop screen. I don't actually have a physical product here to show you at the moment, but unsurprisingly, it looks just like the product on their website. So the nice thing about the FuelTech FT550, which is pretty unique in the aftermarket ECU world, is it is an ECU as well as a dash display or driver display, as well as a built-in logger. So I don't think I've seen any other products that basically combine all three into one part, one component. Another nice thing with the FuelTech FT550 or FuelTech ECUs in general is that it is touchscreen, and while no, you're probably not going to be programming the entire fuel and ignition curve from that touchscreen, it is helpful if you're in the staging lanes before a run and maybe the weather changes and you decide that you need to pull a little bit of RPM out of your two-step, or maybe go a little bit less aggressive, then you can do that straight from that touchscreen. You don't need to sprint back to the pits and grab a laptop. So this ECU comes with all of the functionality that you'd expect from a high-end ECU, and it is making waves, of course, in the drag racing world where it's becoming a pretty popular choice. So we've got the FT550 ECU. We are also giving away, as part of that, our tuning suite of courses, so that you'll know what to actually do once you've got that ECU and you've got it installed in your car. So total package value there, about $3,000 US. We have got 12 days left for that giveaway to run. So if you are keen to get your name into the draw, we will ship it to your door regardless where you are in the world. Then click the link that Sam's putting into the comments. It'll take you through to the page that you're looking at here. There are also a few additional tasks that you can complete that will give you more entries into the draw, giving you more chance to win. Now, I did do a little bit of an update last webinar about progress on our SR86. And again, I'm going to apologize for the glacial speed with which we're moving with this. But understandably, we have been pretty busy here at HPA. And we've got a lot of course content that is coming up, which I'm going to talk about as well. But progress is, in fact, progressing. Just wanted to jump across to my laptop screen here and show you a couple of things that we've been working on at the moment. So one of these is... modification here to the rocker cover. So this is actually a secondhand rocker cover that we picked up. Obviously the engine bay's close to being completely back together. And one of the problems with the SR20 is that if we want to get access to the vernier cam gears, the vernier adjustable cam gears which sit behind here, we've got to take the whole rocker cover off. And that's a bit of a problem with cam chain engines. Obviously the cam chain does end up lubricated, so it can't sit behind a easy to remove cover like a cam belt often does. The problem is magnified with our installation, which is a little hard to see, but once we've got the coils installed here, we've got a set of R35 GTR coils, which are a coil on plug fitment. Those all need to come off, and that's pretty fiddly because the design for this rocker cover was never intended for coil on plug. So it's pretty fiddly removing the coils, and then we've also got the wiring harness for those coils, which runs sort of off the back here. So basically, if we want to make an adjustment to the cam timing on the dyno, it's probably about a 30-minute round-trip operation, which is not unachievable, but is definitely a pain when you're making iterative small changes. It really makes you second guess whether you want to try another degree of advance or retard on the particular cam you're working on. So the solution we've got here is we have actually got a secondhand cover, and we have sliced the front of it, which is what you can see here. Now, of course, understandably, that's going to create a big oil leak. So we're not intending, obviously, to drive the car or race the car with this rocker cover on it. But it is going to be absolutely perfect for our dyno purposes. The idea here is what we're going to do is just simply seal that crack or that split up with a section of race tape while we're on the dyno. It's not ideal. Obviously, it's going to get hot. Our race tape's not going to like that too much. And it is still going to get sprayed with oil. But this is only a short-term solution, purely to get us through our tuning. But the result of doing this means that all we need to do in order to make a cam timing change is basically undo these three 10mm headed bolts. We can quickly and easily remove that front section and get full access to our vernier adjustable cam gears. So that's going to make life heaps easier when it comes to adjusting our cam timing. Now, as part of this as well, this is actually going to become a worked example for a brand new course that we are just completing. So I'll talk about that in a moment. That's our cam tuning course. Another thing we've been working on here, and I did mention this in our last webinar, Jimmy, our fabricator, has been getting pretty busy with some heat protection products. Obviously, turbocharged engines create a lot of heat, and managing that heat is really important if you want reliability and you don't want to basically fry all of the components that are around the exhaust system. So there's a few components that are going on here, or a few products that are being used here. First of all, we've got some heat reflective tape. So that's basically wrapping the back of the firewall as well as the passenger side chassis rail here, being obviously this is a left-hand drive car. We have also got some heat wrap here. This section here is our main engine harness. It's a bit unfortunate where we've had to route this. Obviously, routing a harness right behind the exhaust front pipe is not our first choice, but we really were left with limited options. So we wanted to go to every extent to try and protect it. So this starts with the DR25 sheathing that goes around the harness. Obviously, that in and of itself is not any heat protection. It's really abrasion resistance as well as protecting us from fluids or moisture that ends up in the engine bay. Then we've got this gold heat wrap. This is actually a DEI product that is designed more for wrapping around the likes of fuel and oil lines, but obviously it's still going to do the job here. It is lined with a fiberglass product as well, so that's another layer of insulation for our wiring harness. Going a little bit further, there is an air gap, and then these heat shields here, which Jimmy has bent up and then mounted off this alloy bracket that you can see. So that's going to do a pretty good job. Going a little bit further, we've also got the wrap that has been made up for the front pipe there, and that also goes around the exhaust manifold. So I just want to talk about this product here. I'll just grab this so I can remember what it's from, because no doubt we're going to be asked. So this is from HeatShield Products. We'll go to our overhead camera here. So it's quite an interesting product in that it's an aluminized product on the outside. So that's what we can see here. And then it's got this insulating material on the other side. So the idea with it is it's pretty easy to shape. It's pretty easy to cut. So you can manipulate this and basically create shields and multiple parts that go around all of the hot side components on the exhaust manifold and front pipe. So the idea behind it is, technically, I don't know if I'm too keen to try it out, once everything's up and running on the dyno, should actually be able to basically touch the outside of that, and it shouldn't end up leaving you with third degree burns again. I'm not sure that I'm going to put that to the test, but definitely should be a lot better than what we had just with some heat wrap around that front pipe. So again, for those who are interested, that came from HeatShield Products, not a paid advert. We simply purchased the stuff. Now, if we jump back to my laptop screen as well, we'll see at the moment we've got our brand new Tile Sport stainless exhaust housing there. And obviously that's another source of heat. For those who are wondering about the routing of the O2 sensor, exhaust gas oxygen sensor there, this is not how it runs. It actually ends up running over to a wideband controller that sits over here. It's just basically sitting there for the moment. So don't worry, we're not going to burn that on our exhaust housing. But again, this is the product we are using here. This is an Inconel molded heat shield. We'll get it over under our overhead camera. So this is a product made by Turbolone, and this one is for the existing GTX 30 exhaust housing, which you can see there. So it is two-piece, and basically it just attaches with safety wire. So if you're interested in looking for something like that, I think Turbolone make these for a range of different popular exhaust housings. So again, you can check out Turbolone's website, TurboSource, to find those. Again, not a paid advert. It's a product that I personally love, and we simply purchased that off Turbolone when we were building the SR86. Now, moving on, another thing we've been working on over the last little while is a couple of worked examples on our GM LS, or LS2 L98 actually. We've got an Australian domestic market 2009 VESS Commodore, and I know for those of you who are in the US market, you never got this vehicle, but it's actually badge engineered as a Pontiac G8 over there. Anyway, long and short of it is, it doesn't really matter too much the car, because essentially the LS variant in terms of cam upgrades pretty similar across the board. So just to show you the sort of gains we can expect from swapping out a stock cam in an LS2 or L98, in this case we've gone with a Kelford Cam's HS108D, which is a pretty big cam. It's getting up there in terms of about as big as you'd likely go with a stock unopened engine. But if we jump across to my laptop screen here, we can sort of see the results here. So I think in all in, we were around about 340 wheel horsepower in stock form on our mainline Pro Hub dyno prior to fitting the cam. So that's the red line you can see on the dyno graph there. Now, that wasn't a completely stock engine though. We already had a VCM suite over the radiator cold air intake, and we also had a set of 1 7/8 stainless headers, 3-inch cat-back exhaust, and high flow catalytic converters. So it's not really a fair comparison. But the blue line, which you can see peaking all the way up here at about 460 wheel horsepower, that's what we ended up getting with our HS108D cam upgrade. So anytime you can pick up a handy 120 wheel horsepower with just a cam swap, that's pretty serious power. That's what we can expect. The problem with these cam swaps is twofold. First of all, to get the right results out of a cam upgrade, regardless what engine it's going in, we need to make sure that the cam is degreed to the manufacturer's specification sheet. If we haven't done that, the valve opening and closing events aren't going to occur at the correct point. That'll influence whereabouts in the power curve, or the RPM range, I should say, we make peak power and peak torque. The other aspect is, if we get this really wrong, we're likely to run into problems with mechanical contact between the valves and the pistons. And obviously, that's never really going to end well. So it is twofold. First of all, we need to understand how to degree the cam correctly, and then we also need to understand the tuning aspect, because when we fit such a large aggressive cam into a stock LS engine, it really does have a major impact on our tuning, and we need to address that. Now, for the eagle-eyed among you, you may actually notice here what does look like a bit of an idiosyncrasy. If we look at the low end of our power curve, we'll actually see that it looks like our HS108D has picked up power everywhere. That's not really the case. This is just an implication of the torque converter in our automatic transmission. So I put this down to basically a run-to-run variation. And the reality is that if we did a comparison, we'd probably end up with a curve that meant something like this. Basically, when we're looking at upgrade camshafts, there's no free lunch, and where we pick up power, which we're hoping will generally be in the mid-range to high RPM, we'll generally end up losing a little bit in the bottom end, and that's a sacrifice that personally I'm quite happy to take. But you do need to be mindful when you are choosing the cam. A lot of people with a street car will look at the options available from a particular cam supplier, and they'll just go straight to the biggest, baddest, ugliest camshaft that the manufacturer makes and think that that's going to give them the best results. Seldom does that work out. Firstly, these cams do need to be chosen based on the other modifications to support the cam. So head flow, valve size, compression ratio, intake and exhaust systems all play into this. The other thing is that a cam that is really designed to optimize power up at 7,000 or 8,000 RPM, generally, you're going to end up with horrible drivability and very little power and torque down in the sort of 1500 to 3000 RPM range, which is what we rely on for daily driven use. So your drivability is going to suffer, not to mention your fuel economy. So those are considerations you need to make. Sometimes a slightly milder grind cam that gives a wider power curve is actually going to make for a more enjoyable and all-round faster car if you are on the street. Now, in terms of that, we've got two of our courses that are getting a little bit of attention. So first of all, let's jump over to the How to Degree a Cam course. And this is a course that I know a lot of people need but don't necessarily have right now. So I just wanted to talk about it. So aftermarket cams, probably one of the most common ways people modify an engine in order to improve power and torque when they're building in a performance engine. And the problem, as I mentioned though, is if we don't degree the cam properly, you're not going to get the best results. And alternatively, you can also end up with damage. So this is a course we produced a little while ago that really covers everything you need to know. In particular, we cover the camshaft fundamentals. So basically the operation of the valve train. Obviously there's a variety of different types of valve train, and we'll cover all of those there. You'll also learn, for example, what the camshaft specification sheet actually means. All those numbers, what do they mean, and what do we actually need to understand from that. We also cover in here what you'll actually need in order to degree cams. It's not a hell of a lot either. You don't need to be spending a lot of money in order to degree your cams. And it is a skill that the average enthusiast with a bit of an eye for detail and patience can absolutely learn. We've got a section here that covers some of those practical skills, such as how to find true top dead center, how to use a dial gauge, and how to read your degree wheel, then actually making your camshaft adjustments. We've got a really nice, simple, succinct, six-step camshaft degreeing process. This is applicable regardless of if you've got a relatively simple pushrod LS V8, or you've got a quad cam V12 with four variable cam wheels or vernier cam gears. It doesn't matter anything in between. The six-step process is applicable. Now, why I wanted to bring your attention to this is our library of worked examples, which if you follow any of our courses, this library of worked examples is essentially a bit of a walkthrough of that process so you can see how it works. Currently, we've got a Honda B18C in there. We've also got our Nissan SR20, which I just showed you in our Toyota 86. And hopefully, in the not too distant future, we'll have that full worked example in there on the LS. So obviously ours is an LS2/L98, but this will be applicable for the wider range of LS engines. So if you're interested in that course, $49, you can find it at hpacademy.com/courses. The other part of that puzzle, though, is the tuning. As I mentioned, that needs to be dealt with. So as part of this upgrade, we also presented or developed a worked example for our practical reflash tuning course. So I'll just quickly dive over to that. Our practical reflash tuning course is one of our courses that teaches you how to tune factory engine management systems using the process of reflashing. This is a process that's becoming increasingly popular on late model cars, where it has become difficult to remove that factory ECU and fit an aftermarket standalone. The reason for this is the whole car basically relies on messaging between the different electronic modules. You remove the factory ECU out of the car, you may be able to get the engine running, but probably the transmission won't change gear, your gauge cluster won't work, the air conditioning may not work, and a range of other problems. So reflashing allows us to read the information out of that factory ECU, modify it, and then flash it back in. So this is applicable for any reflashing package, regardless whether you're using commercial software such as HP Tuners or EFI Live, EQTech, Cobb, doesn't really matter, or open source freely available software such as ROM Raider or maybe ECU Flash. We cover the basics of reflashing here. So what you actually need to know about reflashing and how it varies from tuning an aftermarket standalone. I will also cover the operating principles of a factory ECU, and these can vary quite dramatically, again, from a aftermarket standalone. Really important to understand what you're actually trying to achieve. I also cover some of the basics, such as data logging, which you're going to be relying on when you're reflashing, because in most instances, you won't be able to make live tuning changes in real time. We also cover how to change your fuel delivery and your ignition timing. We cover some of the advanced topics here, such as MAF rescaling, really important with any ECU that uses a mass airflow sensor, how to adjust your calibration for larger injectors, how to perform a speed density conversion to remove the airflow meter, boost control, and a few others in there. We've got a six-step process, just like our CAM control, our CAM degreeing course, and this will teach you a simple process you can apply regardless what you are tuning. Now, all of the course is delivered on our dyno, but we know we've got customers in cities and even countries around the world with no dyno. If you've got no option, then the road or the racetrack is a valid option for performing your tuning. So we'll teach you how to do that as well. Now, the worked example, so again, informal walkthrough of that process. We vary both the car that we're tuning as well as the ECU platform, the reflashing platform. We cover the EQTech platform on the Subaru BRZ Toyota FRS. We cover the HP Tuners platform on the GM LS. In this case, we've got a basic example here. We were just doing some light modifications. More advanced example, we were doing mass airflow sensor rescaling as well as GM's virtual volumetric efficiency subsystem. We perform a one bar speed density operating system patch to remove the airflow meter. We also cover the Hondata platform on the Honda DC5 Integra. We cover HP Tuners on the 2014 Ford F-150, the Cobb access port on a 2015 Subaru WRX, and we recently also added an ECU flash on our version 11 Subaru STI. We've been asked for a long time now for a big cam tuning worked example, so that's exactly what we're going to be adding in there. That is a few weeks away at the absolute most, so we'll let you know a little bit more when that is out, but you can find that course again at hpacademy.com/courses. Our practical standalone and reflash tuning courses, $229 US each. Now, we've talked a little bit about cams, and I want to talk about another course that I am in the midst of filming at the moment. It's actually been put back a little bit because yesterday, while filming a module on the dyno, I managed to strip fourth gear in our turbocharged Toyota 86, which is not ideal, but fourth gear is a bit of a known weakness on these cars, and when we're making almost twice the factory power, it's also potentially not unexpected. So continuously variable cam control is something that I know a lot of tuners don't fully understand, and we constantly get asked about tuning strategies for continuously variable cam control. First of all, I'll just define what that actually is, and it's a technology that's definitely common now, whereby the actual cam timing can be advanced or retarded as the engine's running very, very quickly by the ECU. So this basically allows us to have the best of both worlds. We can have cam timing that is optimized for low RPM airflow, so optimizing our power and torque at low RPM, but then at high RPM, we can also choose cam timing settings that suit optimizing the airflow at that point. The idea here is it gives us a broader power and torque curve. Now, I remember early in my career when variable cam control engines were just starting to become popular, most of the aftermarket standalone ECUs didn't support it. And a number of those manufacturers were heard to say that there was no advantage in it and it was just a gimmick. And the reality is that's simply not the case. The reality is that their ECUs simply couldn't control the system and they were trying to make excuses. Let's jump across to my laptop screen here and we'll see exactly how powerful this is. So this is two runs here from our Toyota 86 turbocharged engine. Power and torque overlaid on top. The red run there, or the red runs, power and torque, you can see the two lines are with the cam control for the both inlet and exhaust cams optimized. We can see at that particular point we've got somewhere in the region of 60 odd horsepower gain, so certainly not insignificant at 4000 RPM. The other aspect here is that we can see that right at the top of the rev range, we aren't giving anything away in terms of power. So it's broadened that torque and power curve significantly, particularly down at sort of 4,000 RPM. So massive improvement from there. And certainly if you are looking at that and the option of running cam control or not running cam control, I certainly know which one I'd take. So the whole crux of how that works, I'll just go to our overhead camera. This is a cam gear off our FA20 and basically I've opened this up. So part of this is attached to the cam. The sprocket at the back you can see is attached to the cam chain itself, and we can see that basically the whole system can rotate. I've got these lobes in here, and these chambers in here basically are filled with high pressure engine oil, and by favoring the oil flow to one side of the lobe versus the other, the cam can be advanced or retarded really quickly while the engine is running. So this gives us a lot of power as tuners, but we need to know what we're doing with this. We'll just jump across to the tuning software here for a moment. This is the Motec M150 system, but essentially all of the ECUs give a very similar result here. So here we're looking at our camshaft target table. So this particular one here is for our inlet cam target. And we've got it represented numerically and then graphically out to the right-hand side. So if we just bring this table, full size it a little bit here, and we can see that we've got RPM horizontal axis and we've got engine load on the vertical axis, so we can control the cam target relative to those parameters. What we can see is that we're advancing the cam through the mid-range around peak torque, and then as the RPM increases we end up retarding the cam, so it's basically back to its full retard position by 7000 RPM. We've got the same controls for the exhaust cam, and how that looks if we grab some data, we'll just have a quick look here. This is a screen capture from the Motec M150 during a ramp run. So we can see up here we've got our engine RPM during that ramp run. Here we've got the intake cam bank position for the left bank, bank one position, so it's the left bank, bank two position for the right bank of cylinders. And in there, you basically can't see it because they're overlaid on top of each other so nicely. There's a red line in there, which is the target coming from that table that we just looked at. And to control all of that, we can see down here, we've got the duty cycle for the two solenoids that control the cam position. Now, one of the things a lot of people think with continuously variable cam control is that we can run two cams off one output. That's simply not the case. This is a closed loop control strategy that's looking at the actual measured cam position, comparing that to our target, and then deciding what to do to the solenoid duty cycle. And we will see variations as we go through the rev range. And you can see that, particularly if we look in here, while the duty cycle for the left and right bank of cylinders is similar, it's obviously not exactly the same. So that's important. And really, the whole system relies on how well the closed loop control strategy, which is known as a PID control algorithm, works. So, a lot of information to take in, but that cam control course is in the last stages of filming, and we're hoping to have that out within the next month or so. Again, we'll keep you in the loop with that. I'll just head back over to my notes here for a second. I just want to do a little reminder. I did mention this in our last one. I've kept over to my laptop screen. High Performance Academy now has our very own podcast. We've called that HPA Tech Talk. And you can find that anywhere that podcasts are normally listened to. So head across to HPATechTalk.com if you want to get involved with that. Great way to absorb our information without needing to stare at a YouTube video for half an hour or so. And I'll get Sam also to put a link to HPATechTalk.com in the comments that you can click through to as well. All right, we're running a little bit long here, so I will finish up just by reminding you that we are running that FuelTech FT550 giveaway. 12 days left to get your name into the draw for that giveaway. It's also going to come with our suite of tuning courses, $3,000 worth of value shipped directly to your door. No catches there. Free to get your name into the draw. You don't need to purchase anything. So again, I'll get Sam to drop another link into the comments that you can follow to get your entry in. All right, thanks for joining us there. Give me a moment and we'll get started with today's lesson.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.